stand together. Welcome, welcome. Let's sing.
Darkness I was rejected and cut off from hope. I couldn't see his love for me. He said he's not who he seems. Don't get your hopes up for him. Lies fell away when I saw his face. Oh my first delight, I saw delight in his eyes when he looked at me. Now my whole world's on fire, alive in the presence that burns inside of me. Now I know whose I am. Forever I'll stand on your truth.
Tommy Kreitz, and I serve on staff as the co-campus pastor of the Elgin campus, and I lead our Harvest students on all campuses, and I'm so glad that you joined us. Hey, we'd love to know where you're watching from today, so let us know in the chat or in the comments. And listen, if it's your first time with us, I want to especially welcome you. No matter where you're joining us from today, we are so glad that you are here. And whether you're new or you come every single week, we want to invite you to check in. You could do that on this page on the Harvest website. You could do it through a link in the comments on YouTube and Facebook or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. And we would love to know that you're here today and how we can be praying for you this week as well. So thank you so much for doing that. And listen, if you're not a guest, we want to help you worship the Lord through giving. Quick reminder that there are four ways to give. And you can give online on this page. You can also hold up your camera on your phone up to the QR code on this screen, and it will take you directly to the giving page on the Harvest website. You can give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, through a text or by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus as well. Well, today in our service, we're going to be remembering the Lord as we take communion. So find some juice and a cracker or a small piece of bread and be ready to observe this ordinance of the church together. And to prepare our hearts, let's read 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 26. It says this, "For I've received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" It's awesome. So excited to do that as a church together. Well, listen, also today on our campuses, we're hosting an event. We're calling it Find Your Lane, and it is designed to help people find a place to use their gifts and passions in serving the Lord in a ministry of the church. And so we would invite you to be involved as well. And we have ways for you to serve from home and online. And you can get all the details at harvestnow.info. Well, this is for our young adults. If you're a young adult, you're not going to want to miss the February gathering at our Rolling Meadows campus. The night is including worship with vertical worship leaders, fellowship, and an intentional panel discussion on dating, healthy relationships, and singleness. Trust me, you want to be there. It's this Thursday, February 25th at 6:30 p.m. And if you need any more details, you can go to harvestnow.info. Well, Dr. Rydelnik concludes our study in the book of Ruth today. And next Sunday, we're going to be going through a two-week series on the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Very excited to bring God's word to our church on this topic. You know, in this unusual season in our world, it's easy to feel disconnected. And women, we want to invite you to engage and connect at Harvest Women's Conference on March 5th through the 6th. It's going to be taking place in person at Rolling Meadows and the Elgin campuses, and it's also going to be available online. We've got some great keynote speakers, including Amy Orr Ewing, Rochelle Burlock, Patty Height, and Beth Freeman. The conference is going to feature worship and workshops and community, and we want you to be a part of it. So you can sign up today at harvestnow.info. Well, listen, as we continue in worship, would you join me in prayer? Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we can come and we can worship your name. And so, Lord, we pray right now that you would clear our minds and our hearts of any distraction maybe that we're feeling from this week or any distractions that may be happening in our homes right now. And would we be able to focus in on worshiping you, on lifting your name high, from hearing from you, Lord, from your word. We're so excited to engage in worship, and we pray, Lord, that it would be a blessing to you. Lord, would you bless our day today as we worship you? Would you bless our week as we go out from this place? We love you. We love to sing your praises, Lord. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name.
causing you silence.
You silence fear and all shame. You conquer death and the grave. To you the glory, Jesus. You broke the curse of our sin. The life of heaven begins. To you the glory, Jesus. Silence fear and all shame. You conquered death and the grave. To you the glory, Jesus. You broke the curse of our sin. The life of heaven begins. To you the glory, Jesus. Oh, worthy are you, God. Oh, worthy is your name. You're worthy of all our praise. We worship you.
That's what it's all about. It's all about the thing that we just sang about the gospel of Jesus Christ. That while we were still sinners, Jesus chose to die for us. That we can only love because he first loved us. Each of you have the communion elements with you, so why don't you go ahead and grab those right now in your hands. From Matthew chapter 26. But all throughout Scripture, every place where it talks about communion, there is an element of it that revolves around this word, remembrance. We're remembering the death and the sacrifice and the love and then ultimately the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But in this specifically, in this act specifically, Jesus sets apart this as something where we're to remember the body that was broken for us, for our sins. The body that was meant to be our body. And the blood that was spilled out that was meant to be our own blood. It says in Matthew chapter 26, verse 26. It says, now as they were eating, Jesus took bread and after blessing it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and eat. This is my body. Now, before we take that, before we eat, just as it commands us in Scripture, let's just take the moment and remember for the things that we've done, for our own salvation, our own redemption, our own reconciliation to the Father. This was his body broken for us. Let's go ahead and take it. It says, and he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, just pause there. Lord, thank you the story of the God of the universe dying for us isn't something that you just step into, but it's something that you wrote yourself out of love. So thank you, Lord. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Let's take the blood. That passage, it says, before they went out, before they went anywhere, it says they sang hymns together. So that's what we're going to do next. We're just going to worship the Lord, continue to worship him through song. Sing some songs that we know all together.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy. Yes, Lord. Bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, I worship his holy. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all of your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to cry. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. God, I worship your holy name. God, I worship your holy. Times I fail, still your mercy remains. And should I stumble again, still I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all things. And praise become my embrace to love you from the inside. In my heart, in my soul, my heart, in my soul, Lord, I give you control, consume me. You, Lord, forevermore.
end our time of worship here with this confession. Let's pull up the lyrics there of this first verse. Before we sing that, let's just meditate on it for 10, 15 seconds, right here. If there's any achievement that we hold dear, maybe even it's any burden that we feel we have the duty to carry, feel it's too much to bear, this is the time to lay it down.
We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus.
Father, thank you for the way that you've made access for us. Access to your Holy Spirit. Access to be able to come, not seen as the things that we've done, not seen as the things that we carry, but seen with the righteousness covered by the blood and fully justified by your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, that you don't leave us like you found us, but you choose to walk with us, to walk us through sanctification, making us more like yourself. But the hardest days and the worst days are the days that you choose to show us your strength. God, I'm thankful for that. Lord, we open our hearts to you, to the perfect one, to the holy one, to the one who's set apart, full of compassion, full of mercy, full of love. Open our hearts to you, Lord. Would you shape us in your hands? And just as we gave thanks for your body and for your blood, Lord, we say thank you for your presence. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen, church. It's really sweet and special to worship together, right? Amen. Hey, let's go ahead and take a seat as we open up God's Word together.
Good morning. I am so happy to see that all of you are out there. I can't actually see everyone watching, but I'm so glad that all across six campuses we are worshiping together. I am so grateful for all of you. Thanks for being part of this. I don't know if you've noticed, I'm wearing my shirt over here. It says Moody Radio. Do you see that? Hopefully, sometimes you get to listen in on Saturday mornings, 9 to 11 on Open Line. I love answering people's Bible questions, and if you've never listened before, you can now. 90.1 FM Moody Radio, you can podcast, listen on the Moody Radio app, whatever you like. I just wanted to remind you of the opportunity to listen to Open Line. So great to be with you, and I'm really excited about talking with you a little bit more through the book of Ruth. Now, when my younger boy was about 6 years old, we got the VHS tape of Aladdin. And I must have watched Aladdin hundreds of times with him. He loved Aladdin, and I loved it too. It's a wonderful movie, and I loved Robin Williams' portrayal of the genie. It was so funny. But one of my favorite concepts from that movie was the way the genie described himself as all the power of the universe in a little lamp. And I thought about that, about how great that would be to have all the power of the universe at my command. When I have a difficulty or a disappointment, all I have to do is rub that lamp and the genie comes out, takes care of everything. And here's what's amazing to me. I believe this, that sometimes when we are facing disappointing times and difficulties and adversity, sometimes I think that we would prefer to have a genie than what we do have, which is the God of the universe. When we're in a tight spot or a difficult situation, when there's an illness or a lost loved one or a financial setback, maybe a job loss or a divorce, some sort of fractured relationship, any kind of disappointment with life at all, all we have to do is rub the lamp and the genie appears and deliverance. That's what we would like. But we don't have a genie. No, no, no. We do have all the power of the universe who cares about us. We have the God of the universe, the Creator. He's the Redeemer. He's the all-powerful and wise God, the God of the universe. He is the one who we go to with our disappointments and our difficulties, and he is very different from a genie. He does things differently. He handles situations differently. He works differently. And we see how the God of the universe deals with very difficult times, disappointing times in the book of Ruth, and how God does produce deliverance through difficult times, through disappointing times. Now, let's review what we've covered so far. This is our fourth week studying finding hope in disappointing times from the book of Ruth. To begin with, there was a famine that drove Elimelech, Naomi, and their two sons to Moab. They stayed there for a short time, they thought, but they ended up staying a long time, for 10 years, much longer than they expected. Elimelech died, leaving his wife, Naomi, a widow in a foreign land. The two sons married Orpah and Ruth, and both those boys, those men, died, Kilian and Mahlon. They passed away, leaving two more widows. And then Naomi decides to go back home to Bethlehem, and Orpah says, I'll stay here in Moab with my God and my people. But Ruth is determined to return with Naomi because she says, your people will be my people and your God will be my God. And so she goes back. And after they're back, Ruth works in the fields to provide food through the care for the poor that's available, the social welfare program of the Torah. And she works in the fields, and there she happens upon the field of Boaz, and there she meets Boaz, a relative who could be a kinsman redeemer. A redeemer is someone who could marry her, perhaps, and raise up an inheritance for her dead husband. And so she meets him. She talks to Naomi about this. Naomi tells her to go and invite him to propose marriage to Boaz. And that's exactly what she does. According to Jewish Torah, Levirate law, he could be her redeemer. And there's a complication. Boaz says there's a nearer relative that could be the one that could raise up inheritance. He would go talk to him. But he promises that if that man does not want to raise up an heir, does not want to become Ruth's husband, he would, as the Lord lives, he says, do it himself, and he would marry her. And that's where we finished last week. Let's see if we can remember sort of the summary of the book of Ruth. Chapter 1, we have a key word, weeping, and that's where we see Ruth's determined faith. Chapter 2 is working, that's where we see diligent faith. In chapter 3, we saw waiting, that's where we see her dependent faith on God and others. And then fourth, we see wedding, where we see God delivering her. That's a delivering faith. And so that's what we're up to. Now, when we look at Ruth 4, we're going to see this. Here's what we learn in Ruth chapter 4, that God will indeed deliver us from disappointment, but he'll do it in the most surprising ways. God will deliver us from disappointment. He will rescue us, but he's going to do it in unexpected ways. God restores our fortunes. He makes things better. He will do it ultimately, but he does it in ways that always amaze us, that we were not expecting at all. And so what we're going to do as we look at Ruth 4, we're going to see God's surprising ways of deliverance. That's what we're up to. So get out your Bible, and let's look at Ruth chapter 4 together. We're going to read Ruth 4. Boaz went to the gate of the town and sat down there. Soon the family redeemer Boaz had spoken about came by. Boaz called him by name and said, "Come over here and sit down." So he went over and sat down. Then Boaz took 10 men of the town's elders and said, "Sit here." And they sat down. He said to the redeemer, "Naomi, who has returned from the land of Moab, is selling a piece of land that belonged to our brother Elimelech. I thought I should inform you. Buy it back in the presence of those seated here and in the presence of the elders of my people. If you want to redeem it, do so. But if you do not want to redeem it, tell me that I will know, because there isn't anyone other than you to redeem it, and I am next after you." "I want to redeem it," he answered. Then Boaz said, "On the day you buy the land from Naomi, you will also acquire Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the deceased man, to perpetuate the man's name on his property." The redeemer replied, "I can't redeem it myself, or I will ruin my own inheritance. Take my right of redemption, because I can't redeem it." At an earlier period in Israel, a man removed his sandal and gave it to the other party in order to make any matter legally binding concerning the right of redemption or the exchange of property. This was the method of legally binding a transaction in Israel. So the redeemer removed his sandal and said to Boaz, "Buy back the property yourself." Boaz said to the elders and all the people, "You are the witnesses today that I am buying from Naomi everything that belonged to Elimelech, Chilion, and Mahlon. I will also acquire Ruth the Moabitess, Mahlon's widow, as my wife, to perpetuate the deceased man's name on his property, so that his name will not disappear from among his relatives or from the gate of his home. You are witnesses today." The elders and all the people who were at the gate said, "We are witnesses. May the Lord make the woman who is entering your house like Rachel and Leah, who together built the house of Israel. May you be powerful in Ephratah. May your house become like the house of Perez, the son Tamar bore to Judah, because of the offspring the Lord will give you by this young woman." Now, God's going to surprise us in the way he delivers us. And the first surprise method, the first way he'll surprise us, he will surprise us with his methods. God will surprise us with his methods. We see the story here. Boaz gathers at the gate. That's the place, that's the court system. That's the place for legal judgments. And so he gathers all the elders. He gathers 10 men to sit sort of as a jury for the legal judgment. They form a quorum of witnesses. And there he makes the offer to the nearer relative, who, by the way, is not mentioned by name. In fact, the Hebrew would describe him sort of like Mr. So-and-so. His name, he's so disliked, we don't want to even know his name. That's sort of how the story is told. Anyway, he is offered from Boaz to redeem Naomi's land from Elimelech. Because widows did not inherit land. They needed to keep it in the family, so a near relative would be willing to buy it from Naomi. And Naomi was past childbearing, so she didn't have any opportunity to marry and raise up a child. Now, the stipulation, the man says, yeah, I'll buy the land. But he says, well, if you do that, you must marry Ruth. And if you marry Ruth, then your inheritance will go in the name of Ruth's husband. And no longer will it be yours. Well, the man says, I don't want to jeopardize my inheritance. When I marry and I have kids, I don't want that to go in his name. I want it to be in my name. No, I'm not going to marry her. And so he opts not to do that. And then there's this discussion. A decision is made. They have a sandal covenant. Again, that's an ancient custom that we're not really so sure of. They exchange sandals, and that makes a binding contract. And the binding contract is that Boaz was within his rights to redeem Ruth. And he, amazingly, Ruth marries him to raise up an heir for her husband, her first husband who's died. So in essence, what is happening here is that Boaz doesn't care about his own posterity. He is sacrificing his inheritance to raise up an heir for Ruth's family. And of course, the people bless her, and they talk about maybe be like Rachel and Leah, have great fertility, have many children, have wealth and fame, and like Perez, have many descendants in Judah as a result of a Levirate marriage. Here's the point. God used normal events. That's what the methods he used. Totally normal events to deliver us rather than supernatural acts. There is nothing supernatural in this chapter. When God delivers us, he's going to use totally normal events most of the time. I'm not saying God can't do miracles. He does do miracles, but they are miracles. That means they are rare events. What I am saying, though, is that normally when God acts to deliver us, what surprises us, he uses totally normal events. Now, what do I say by normal events? Well, he uses normal provision. That's one of the ways he does it. If you remember in Ruth 2:23, Ruth the Moabitess went out, and what she did is she went into the fields, and she gleaned from the corners of the fields. And so that's normal provision. She said, let me go out into the fields and gather fallen grain behind someone who allows me to do so. So he uses the normal provision that the Torah has. That's how he delivered her. And then also God used a random choice. The random choice is this, that Ruth went out into the field owned by Boaz, but she had no idea. She says, her mother-in-law says, where'd you go out to gather barley today, and where did you work? And Ruth, if you skip down, it says, Ruth told her mother-in-law about the men she had worked with and said, the name of the man I work with today is Boaz. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, may he be blessed of the Lord. It was a random choice. Ruth didn't know where she was going. She said, I'll go to this field. That looks like a good field. And it turned out it was a kind man who loved the Lord and also was a near relative, a redeemer. Who would have thought? God used a random choice. He also used a court case. We have court cases all the time. All sorts of things are binding contracts. Well, Boaz goes to the gate of the city. That's the court system in the ancient world. And there he gathers the elders and he offers the man to redeem the property and Ruth. And the man refuses. He says, on the day that you buy the land from Naomi, you'll acquire Ruth the Moabitess to perpetuate the man's name on his property. And the man says, no, I can't redeem it myself. I don't want to ruin my inheritance. And so what we have is a normal court case. We've got the exchange of sandals. Wouldn't that be nice if that's all we needed? No lawyers, just sandals. That would be nice. But anyway, that's a normal, ordinary situation. God used normal things. Also, not only does he use a court case, he uses a pregnancy. How common is that? Verse 13 says, Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. When he was intimate with her, the Lord enabled her to conceive, and she gave birth to a son. How common is that for young women to get pregnant? That is a totally normal situation. So here's the point. The point is that God will surprise us, not because of the miracles he does. He surprises us because he is the God of the universe who can do anything. But then he chooses to use normal events. This is what we talked about a couple weeks ago. Big word, providence. That God uses providence to accomplish his purposes. He uses seemingly ordinary situations and circumstances, and he works them together, and boom! We think they're coincidences, but it is the hand of God operating. That's what's happening here. He is operating with totally normal events, but he's using them for Ruth's good, and that's what he does in our lives. Adam Smith called it God's invisible hand. They're not miracles, but they're hands of a sovereign God working everything together for good. You know, the way God works in our life is he takes chance meetings or old acquaintances or just the right timing for getting an opportunity for a job or just all sorts of things that we would have thought were completely random and unexpected, and he works them together, and that's how he provides deliverance through normal circumstances. It always makes me think of James Bond. I love the old James Bond movies, not the more recent ones. I like the old ones, but I love it when he would always go at the start of the movie and he'd get the tools that he was going to use, the toys, so to speak. You know, they'd say, well, here's a pen, but actually it's a missile launcher. Or this is a compass, but it actually is a grenade. And there's all these different things that he uses in the movie, and they look totally ordinary, but they're filled with power because that's what the Secret Service has done. His Majesty's service has filled them with power. Well, the same thing in our lives. There are totally normal events that we are facing when we're in disappointing times. It might be someone we know that we have met, a neighbor or someone we met at work. And it might be it just so happened that we encountered someone at church, or it might be someone or some way of something happening that seems totally ordinary, and then God imbues it with power, and that very ordinary thing is how he works it out. God used ordinary, normal events in Ruth's life to provide deliverance. He uses ordinary, normal events in our lives through his providence to provide deliverance. That's the first way God surprises us with his deliverance. He surprises us by his methods. Second way that he delivers us, God will surprise us with his timing. He'll surprise us with his timing. We read already verse 13, but we'll pick it up there. Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife, and when he was intimate with her, the Lord enabled her to conceive, and she gave birth to a son. Then the woman said to Naomi, "Praise the Lord who has not left you without a family redeemer today. May his name become well known in Israel. He will renew your life and sustain you in old age. Indeed, your daughter-in-law, who loves you and is better to you than seven sons, has given birth to him." Naomi took the child, placed him on her lap, and took care of him. The neighbor women said, "A son has been born to Naomi," and they named him Obed. In this story, this is the birth of Obed to Ruth. The Lord enabled conception. This is really important for us to understand, because even though I said it's totally normal for young women to get married and have a pregnancy, we often think that that's just a human event, but it is not totally human. When I was in Israel many, many years ago, before we had kids, the situation was that there was mumps going around, and I was concerned at this conference that I was teaching at that there is mumps spreading through the group, and I had never had mumps, and I said to a doctor who was present, I said, you know, I've never had mumps. I'm a little concerned. Don't you think you should isolate those people? He said, listen, Michael, mostly likely you had mumps, you just didn't know it. And even if you didn't, it probably is not going to affect you if you get it. But here's the bottom line, he said. Children are a gift from the Lord. We say we're going to have a baby, but God is the one that makes it happen. And that's what we see here. We see the Lord enabling Ruth to conceive. And then there's the blessing on Naomi. It is a redeemer, a restorer of life, and to sustain her in old age. And there's the blessing on Ruth, who's better to her than seven sons, her daughter-in-law who loves her. And then the child's relationship with Naomi. It says it here that she took him and placed him on her lap and took care of him. Likely, she became his nurse. That's the most sweet thing for a grandparent, to help with the raising of a child, to care for him, to watch him. Actually, the happiest days that Eva and I have are when we get to watch our grandchildren, to get to be with them and care for them on a regular basis. It is the best thing, and that's what Naomi experiences. And he becomes her son, in a sense, her heir, her descendant, through the Levirate law that God had provided in the book of Deuteronomy. Well, what's the point? God may act slowly to deliver us rather than speedily. In Ruth 4:17, well, let's mention this, that God may very well delay deliverance. It says, the neighbor woman said, now at last Naomi has a son again. Now at last Naomi has a son again. I think that's so crucial for understanding. That is God's delay of deliverance. Naomi's deliverance really took a long time. If we start at the beginning of the problem, there was a famine 10 years previous. And then they disobeyed and went to Moab and made all sorts of problems, and the death of a husband and the death of sons. And then after 10 years, they're back in the land. And you think, okay, now God deliver. But no, there's the harvest season. There's the barley harvest. There's the wheat harvest. And only at the end of the wheat harvest does Ruth ask Boaz to marry her. And when that happens, he says, we've got to wait some more. There's a nearer relative. There's a nearer relative. And so it takes time. God may very well delay his deliverance. They probably, many people think that they were in Bethlehem about 1 to 2 years before Obed was born. When you think about the harvest, the threshing, the marriage, the pregnancy, the birth. So from the beginning of the story to the birth of Obed, when deliverance comes, it's about 11 or 12 years. God doesn't bring deliverance immediately. He may very well delay. Why does God make us wait? So often we want God, oh God, please, please bring me deliverance and do it now. Now, I need it now. Don't you ever feel that way? I'm waiting. Please, God. He doesn't always do that. And his reason is this. His purpose is to teach us endurance. We need staying power. We need perseverance, stick-to-itiveness in our faithfulness to God. He wants us to stay faithful to him over the long haul. That's what's taught in Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. We rejoice in our afflictions, it says, because we know that affliction produces endurance. Endurance produces proven character. And proven character produces hope. That's what we want, hope in a disappointing world. It is only with endurance and character over time that God can do that and give us the hope that we need. God waits. We can always learn to trust more. Time builds our faith. That's what God is doing. It teaches us dependence. We want it immediate, but it doesn't happen that way. God wants things quickly. You know, our nature is we want things very, very quickly. That's the nature of humanity. God wants to build us long term. Think about how we are. I brought this along because that shows, I think, our human nature for wanting immediate deliverance. I was raised on cooked cereal. I loved Quaker oats as a child, and still do. And this is 5-minute oats. All you have to do is boil it and cook them, simmer them for 5 minutes. Now, that doesn't seem so long, but you know, a lot of people think that that's no good. That takes way too long. So what Quaker did is they developed 1-minute oats. Quaker 1-minute oats, there they are. All you have to do is put them in water or milk, boil it for about a minute. It's not as good for you, they'll say, but nevertheless, it will only take 1 minute. We think, oh, that much better, but you know, the truth of it is, it's not really. That takes way too long. So what Quaker came up with was Quaker instant oatmeal. You don't have to boil this at all. What you have to do is put the bag of oats into a bowl, or even keep it in the bag if you're really desperate, and pour some hot water, boiling water on it, mix it around once, now you can eat it. It's not any good for you, but nevertheless, you can eat it very, very quickly. 1 minute oats. No, that's too long. We're gonna go with instant, instantaneously, these are oats. Now that's too long. I don't have time when I'm going to work in the morning or going to school to wait for that water to boil and pour it out. That takes minutes to boil water. So what we have now is Quaker oatmeal to go. Brown sugar, cinnamon, that's good. And basically, it's an oat bar. Eat this, and it's almost like eating oatmeal, but it's without the meal. You don't have to boil, you don't have to cook, you don't have to mix. You just shove it in your mouth and you're out the door. That's sufficient. And this is what our society is like. We want instant oatmeal life. God says, I'm gonna bring you deliverance, but it's gonna take time. I need to build endurance in you, patience, staying power, stick-to-itiveness in faith. Why? Because that's how our lives are transformed. That's how he delivers us, by transforming us into people who hope in God and not in circumstances. That's why God surprises us with his method, because sometimes he doesn't act immediately. He takes time. Besides his methods and his timing being different, there's a third way that God will surprise us. God will surprise us with his perspective. You see, we have this story here. It picks up in chapter 4, verse 18. It says that here in verse 17, they named him Obed, and he was the father of Jesse, the father of David. And then here's the whole point. The whole book, this is the climax. It's the part we skip over. We don't want to read that. It's just a genealogy. That's the point of the book of Ruth. It says, he was the father of Jesse. Obed was the father of Jesse. Who's Jesse? Well, he's the father of David. Who's that? The king of Israel. Wow. Now, this is the genealogy of Perez. Perez fathered Hezron. Hezron fathered Ram, who fathered Amminadab. Amminadab fathered Nachshon, who fathered Salmon. Salmon fathered Boaz, who fathered Obed. And Obed fathered Jesse, who fathered David. That's the story of the book of Ruth. You see, the book of Ruth is teaching us something that's totally different. The principle here is that God always had the ultimate in view rather than the immediate. When we are in disappointing times, we always want to see the immediate. God says, no, I've got an ultimate plan. The ultimate plan is through this unusual story of a Moabite woman married to an older man to raise up an heir. It leads to the family line of King David. King David, that's where he comes from. That's the story. The book of Ruth was written to establish the line of David, but not just the line of David. But when we think of David, it is totally beyond David. So we have here a baby born, Obed, that's the redemption of Naomi. The end of the story? Nope. Judah was promised a special descendant back in Genesis 49. That's the line of the tribe of Judah. It goes through the line of Judah. And then finally, you get to David, the ultimate fulfillment, at least in part. That's what's there. It's sort of like many of us forget that there's an ultimate perspective. But every doctor that does surgery isn't looking at the immediate, which is painful. He's looking at the ultimate. Every dentist, when he does the root canal while we're laying there dying in pain, they have the ultimate hope of bringing relief. See, God has the ultimate picture. The pain may pass, but the ultimate is in view. That's what's happening here. And so he surprises us this way. Now, it's not just David that's the surprise. You see, when we see David, we think of immediately 2 Samuel 7. Verses 12 through 16, where God promised David an heir, a seed, a descendant who would have an eternal house, kingdom, and throne. That's not just any son. That's not Solomon. He's looking forward to the day when David's heir will come, and that's the Messiah, the Lord Jesus, who will reign forever and ever with an eternal house, kingdom, and throne. That's the ultimate that God had in view. He doesn't think of the temporary. He thinks of the big picture. He has the ultimate deliverance in view, not just the deliverance of Ruth and Naomi, not just the deliverance through King David, but also the ultimate deliverance of every one of us through the line of David, through the heir of the house of David, through the Lord Jesus, who is the son of David. Remember this, 2 Timothy 2:8? Jesus, the Messiah, risen from the dead, descendant of David. That's what was the ultimate in view. It was why God had this whole story happen. God never thinks of the immediate. He's thinking of the ultimate. He will surprise us with that perspective. Well, now what? When we look at this, what do we do? How do we leave this? What do we do with the book of Ruth? Well, first of all, I would want to encourage us to see God's hand in everything. If there's anything that Ruth has taught us, that God is working providentially. I was reminded this a number of years ago. There was a man, his name was Gary Witt. He was a teacher in a middle school in New Jersey, and he saw a child choking. What the child was doing, as children do in school, he was sucking on the cap of his pen. He had a big pen, and while he was chewing and sucking on it, he sucked the pen cap into his throat and started to choke. This teacher jumped up, went over to the child, and did the Heimlich maneuver and popped that pen cap out. When they asked him, how did he know how to do it, because he had never been trained, he said, well, I go to this diner every morning for breakfast before school, and I was sitting at the counter, the breakfast counter, and I didn't have a newspaper, and they weren't selling newspapers that day, and I had nothing to read, so I looked up, and behind the counter, they had the signs on how to do the Heimlich maneuver. And so what I did is I read that sign while I was eating my breakfast. I'd never read it before. I'd never even noticed it before. And then I came to school, and the child sucked the cap down his throat, and I jumped up, and I did what I saw on that poster, and I saved his life. He says, I think it was God's timing today that there were no newspapers in that restaurant. But today, he wanted me to know that so I could save a child. See God's hand in everything. That's so vital for us. And then besides seeing God's hand in everything, we need to be about God's business every day. You see, if God is working through us every day, if he is providing deliverance to others through us every day, we need to be about God's business every day. Think about it. When is a police officer on duty? Only when he's on duty? Nope. Police officers are on duty every day, every moment. If there's a crime, they have to act. When is a physician on duty? Ever be on a plane like I've been on where they say, is there a physician aboard? Obviously, there's a medical emergency. The physician doesn't say, you know what? I'm just here. I'm going on vacation. I don't want to help. If there's someone in need, the physician jumps up and is about his business. He is there to help. And we are God's hands. We are his ears. We are his eyes. We are his representatives everywhere. We need to be about God's business every day, everywhere, in all that we do. We are there. We are his agents in everything we do. Be about God's business every day. And then, thirdly, look for God's surprise redemption. You know, we're going through disappointing times. We're going to be surprised at all the ways that God has encouraged us. Look for God's surprise redemption in our lives. At this time, it will come about. You know, Israel expected a glorious king. Instead, God sent the Messiah, Jesus, as a suffering servant. That is the way God redeemed Israel and the world. But it wasn't the expected way. They wanted a political deliverer, and they got someone who died for their sins and rose again and will come back. It was a surprising way of deliverance. Look for God's surprising deliverance. My sister was a teenager. She moved to Israel, and she was living on a kibbutz and started having trouble with her eyes. And two things happened. The trouble with the eyes was the first. The second was she heard her little brother had become a follower of Jesus, and she thought, I had fallen into some cult. And so she decided that she was going to come home, figure out what was wrong with her eyes, and also deliver me from this cult I was in. Well, she came home. No one was sure. She had to see bunches of doctors, but she was so hostile to my faith and argued with me, and I tried talking with her, and it was just a really terrible experience from about July through October. And then in October, they diagnosed her. They said she had multiple sclerosis. And that's why she was having problems with balance and some other issues as well as her eyes. I remember standing outside that hospital room, and I was waiting to go in, and the doctor was telling her that diagnosis. And I heard her sobbing gently when she found out that she had this debilitating disease. And we went in and we hugged her, my whole family. We loved her and said we're there for her and we're going to help her. And she got out of the hospital the next day, and it was Friday night. We had Friday night Erev Shabbat, Eve of Sabbath Bible study that we would go to. And she said to me, hey, do you think I can go to Bible study with you tonight? And I said, absolutely, acting totally nonchalant. And after Bible study, she looked up at our teacher and she said, hey, I'd like to talk more about this. And within about 15 minutes, she had prayed to receive the Lord. You would think the worst news that she had ever gotten up to that point, that she had multiple sclerosis, would be the worst news. But it led her to be open spiritually, and that's how she found ultimate deliverance. I'm wondering if you're here and you think, I've been struggling, I've been suffering, I'm feeling badly, it's a disappointing time. Maybe this is the time that the Lord is even saying to you, you need to put your trust in Jesus. You need to find ultimate deliverance, not just temporal deliverance. Maybe God is speaking to any of us here today that we might need to make that decision to believe that Jesus died for us and rose again, and we can enter into a relationship with him by trusting in him to enter into that, become God's child and live with him forever. That may be the ultimate deliverance. I want to invite you now. I don't want to miss the opportunity. If you have never made that decision, just let's stop right now. And I want to invite you to experience that ultimate deliverance that God has in store for all of us. All you have to do is say, pray this prayer. Father, I know that I did wrong things, and Jesus died for those wrong things. He took the punishment I deserved, and he was raised again, proving he's God. And now I trust him, and I'll follow him. If you prayed that prayer, you have just experienced the ultimate deliverance. Never forget that God will deliver us, but he'll always do it in the most surprising ways. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you that you are the great deliverer. And Father, you may work in ways that we never, ever anticipated, but we're still grateful that you do work. And we give you praise for this in the name of Jesus, our Messiah. Amen.
Dr. Rydelnik, for this great series through the book of Ruth. That's so timely for our circumstances today, isn't it, church? Well, listen, we want to invite you back next Sunday morning at 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock Central Time. And we start a new two-week teaching series next week on the ministry of the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit does in us and through us. And so if you live in the Chicagoland area and you're ready, we'd love to see you in person at one of our six campuses. If not, we'll see you online. Have a great week. You are loved.